like to all take your seats and we will begin. Okay, very warm welcome to everybody and people who are here, and also welcome to people who are watching us online. This morning is communion service led by Russ and Carol. If you are watching online, now is the time to go and find some bread and juice as well so that you can take part in communion with us. Okay, notices. First of all, very warm welcome to Roy, who is now a member. So we're very, very pleased that you've become a member of our church, Roy. So very, very warm welcome to you.
Can we have her at the front so people on video can see who...
Yes, do you want to come up the front, Roy?
Go on.
There we go.
Well, that's the viewers, I'd all do that.
See what happens when you become a member.
And also a big thank you to Roy, who works really hard. He does all the filming now, so Kev has taught him, so thank you. Thank you so much for what you do, Roy. It's lovely. Okay. We had quite a positive church meeting on Wednesday. With many good feedback in the open forum. So the leadership team are going to talk together and then we'll feed back to you all about that. Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock is the ladies' coffee morning. So all ladies are very welcome to that, even if you don't normally come. We meet at the Town and Gown coffee shop in Marston. And we normally have a good, really good chat. And we're normally there for a couple of hours, so even if you can't come at 10, you could come a little bit later, and I'm sure we'll still be there. And we normally get through a couple of cups of coffee as well, don't we? And they've got nice cakes by the looks as well. Okay, so you're very welcome. Next week, Neil is going to preach to us, so something to look forward to. Okay, I've had a letter from Whit and Helen, our missionaries in Thailand. So I've printed off some copies which are on the table over there. I'll just pick out a few things from their letter. They say it's very hot there, 40 degrees centigrade on some days, which is pretty hot. I mean, I like it hot, but 40 degrees is very hot. And they said, while the rest of the world is living with COVID, their village is still on high alert. So they're not able to do quite as much as they normally do. However, one of their teenagers has accepted Jesus, has become a Christian, which is lovely. And a couple of other people have also accepted, a couple of the adults have also accepted Christ. They say after much prayer and exploration, they have found a new location in the village of Tai Hai, about 16 kilometres from Wangdang. So the church parting from Wangdang because they found people to look after the church. Moses, Mary and Fluck are looking after the church in Wangdang so that they can church plant in another area, which is brilliant. You know, they're able to do that. The church is really flourishing in Wangdang. So they plan to move in the beginning of May, and they plan to get involved in the local school. And so they ask for our prayers about that, that it will go really well, and that God will really be in that and lead them to people. And they pray, ask us to pray also for Moses, Mary, and Fluck as they take over the church in Wangdang. And they ask us to pray for their new believers especially, that they will grow in faith. And Whit and Helen are coming to see us soon.
Oh, good.
On the 1st of June. June is really busy, actually. Wednesday, the 1st of June. So they will be sharing with us, coming to Manor Court. And I'd like to do a bring and share like we've done before. So from next week, I will be going around with a list for you to sign up for food to bring. So it'd be really good, because we haven't seen them for a long time. It's all been online, so it'd be really good to see them in person. So that's a date for your diaries, Wednesday, the 1st of June. We have two birthdays. two of the children. We don't actually see them anymore, but I thought I'd mention it anyway. Most of you know Alison and remember Alison very well, Alison Pete. So it's Rachel's birthday. I guess she must be 18, do you think, 17? How old is she? She's working, 17. Lovely. So very happy birthday to Rachel, and she might be listening online, but yeah, happy birthday, Rachel. And also Ray, Maxine's daughter, who probably is a similar age.
She's 18, I think.
She's 18. Wow. They grow up so quickly, don't they, these girls? I remember them as little when they were here. Okay, so happy birthday to those two. Okay, I think that's all the notices. So I'm going to hand over now to Russ and Carol. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, it's Carol initially. Russ is going to do the communion a bit later. But our service today has a theme of peace, faith, love, and hope. And that's because last week, or maybe 2 weeks ago now, Heather sent us a short video clip, and we'd like to share that with you now. Attention. So, peace, faith, love, and hope. I'm going to expand on each of these just a little bit. So first, let's look at peace. Before Jesus went to the cross, he spoke to his disciples to warn them that he was leaving them. He told them that he was going to prepare a place for them and that the Holy Spirit would come. A counselor who would be with them and with us forever. We read in John 14 that Jesus says this: "All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Fantastic words of reassurance these are. And the second candle is faith. This has at least two perspectives, doesn't it? Our faith in God and God's faithfulness to us. In Hebrews 11, we read a long list of Bible characters who've shown extraordinary faith in often difficult circumstances. They include Noah, who built an ark in the middle of the desert; Abraham, who with Sarah had a baby in their old age; Moses, bringing the children of Israel out of Egypt and through the Red Sea, then wandering for 40 years before coming to the Promised Land. And that's to name only three of many more. But this all springs from God's faithfulness to us. In the Old Testament, in Deuteronomy, we can read about Joshua. When he took over from Moses, God spoke through Moses to tell the children of Israel, "You must do what I have commanded you. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of your enemies, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you." And our God never changes. There are many testimonies to that in Scripture, and he is trustworthy and true. He is faithful. So let's sing some songs now that I hope the words of them will reflect our theme and help you to meditate a bit further on these aspects of our beliefs. So stand if you're able, or remain seated if that makes you more comfortable, and we'll worship our God together, beginning with "Faithful One, So Unchanging."
Draw my rod of peace.
will put our trust in God.
Thank you.
So now for our third candle, which is, I said, is love. Just as the word faith has at least two dimensions, the word love has an extraordinary number of aspects. I'm sure you can think of several off the top of your head. For example, love between a parent and a child, romantic love between two people, love for animals, love for chocolate. I could go on. But to focus it down a bit, to relate to what we're talking about spiritually, I want to read to you from Scripture. From 1 John chapter 4, which is headed up, God's love and ours. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. What, no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Saviour of the world. If any acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love that God has for us. God is love. Those who live in love live in God, and God in them. In this way, love is made complete among us, so that we have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If we say we love God, yet hate our brother or sister, we are liars. For any of us who do not love a brother or sister whom we have seen cannot love God whom we have not seen. And he has given us this command: those who love God must also love one another. And of course, we have that well-known passage in 1 Corinthians 13, which is all about love. I'm sure all of you have heard that many times, usually at weddings. So love is not just a lovely, warm, fluffy feeling when you pet your dog or cat. It is so much more. And Jesus made it very clear that love is not just a feeling, but also a doing word. In 3 of the Gospel, we read of the commandments Jesus reiterated to his disciples. I'm going to read from Luke chapter 10, verse 25. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbour? And in reply, I expect you know what Jesus told, the story of the Good Samaritan, which I won't read again. But at the end of it, he said, which of these three do you think was a neighbour to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. So, some demanding words about love. But let's look now at hope, the fourth candle. Hope is another word that has wide interpretation. We quite often hear people saying things like, I hope so, fingers crossed, and they may even cross their fingers to illustrate that. And then there's, I hope so, touch wood. Perhaps some of you use that. And then some people actually look for wood to touch, and if it isn't there, anything wooden around them, what do? Touch their head. What superstitious nonsense that is, really. No. That is not what godly hope is all about. It's not what about at all. It's so much more. Our hope is in God, our Creator, the Rock. It is in Jesus, our Redeemer, the one who paid that terrible price for our sin and secured for us a life everlasting, if we are believers. He's our cornerstone. And our hope is in the Holy Spirit, who is God with us at all times and is there in every situation we experience. There could be a whole sermon on each of these subjects of peace, faith, love and hope, couldn't there? But this has just been a short reminder. So as we come towards our celebration of communion, let's stand to sing just one song, which I think brings together all these elements of peace, faith, love and hope. It's a Hillsong version of what I think may be quite old hymn words, actually. But it's My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. If you don't know it, just listen. But if you do, feel free to join in. Stand if you wish. My hope is built on nothing less. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood. Strong. Let's just pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the different things you lavish on us. As we have been reflecting on this morning, we can find peace that passes any logical understanding. Thank you, Lord. We recognize your faithfulness to each one of us, and we pray that our faith in you will forever increase as we learn from experience to trust in you. Thank you, Lord. We can never cease to be amazed at the depth of your love for all your children. Help us to obey your commands to love God first and foremost, and out of that, to love one another. Thank you, Lord. And as we come to celebrate communion, we remember once again all that Jesus did for us in dying on the cross in our place and for our sin, that we might know your forgiveness. And we thank you for the hope that this brings, a hope of life everlasting and the presence of your Holy Spirit here on earth until the work here is done. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
And, sorry, Chris. And so we come to our act of worship through communion, by reminding ourselves of that peace, faith, love, and hope that Jesus left with us 2,000 years ago. It's easy, isn't it, to think that the Last Supper was the last time that Jesus broke bread when with his disciples. But if we read the account, the Luke's account of Jesus' encounter with his friends on the road to Emmaus after his crucifixion, we actually find something quite extraordinary. Remember that he walked with his friends for some while and they didn't recognize him. They didn't know it was him, and they were expressing concerns and doubts as to what had happened. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further. I love that word, acted as if he was going further. He must have known what was to come. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" I guess it was with a little bit of imagination, I called this sort of like a pub supper. Because he was in a, they must have gone into an inn of some sort, and he went in with them and they sat down. And it appears to me, it may be not to others, but it does to me, that this is the account of the first ever Holy Communion after Jesus' death and his resurrection. But importantly, it was him who was instigating it, because he could tell that his friends had lost that peace, faith, love, and hope that he had talked about before he went to the cross. His friends hadn't recognized him until he broke the bread, and it was only then that their eyes and minds were opened and they recognized him albeit very fleetingly. I looked up the word companion, because that's what they were. He says, then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. I looked up the word companion, and apparently it means the one with whom one eats bread. But it's only through the bread that Jesus became a reality to those friends. It's only through the breaking of bread that their eyes were opened. And the Church of God has been doing it ever since. Every week for some, every month for some, once a year for some. But we've been doing it ever since. The sacrament of bread and wine is spiritual. It's not a ritual. By taking the bread and the wine, it becomes body. It's that body taken into the body of Christ here and now. I found a lovely comment from a Christian writer called Gordon Giles. He said this: Christ has no body on earth but ours. So let's eat wholeheartedly and refuel our determination to live our lives to the glory of God. So, as we take this bread and this wine, we remember and celebrate Jesus' peace, faith, love, and hope. Thank you, Lord, that your death gave us all these things in abundance. And in the same way, today, we once again drink from the cup of everlasting and eternal life and remember and celebrate that precious gift of life that was poured out on that splintered cross. So I invite each one of you to take the bread and eat today. You are the body of Christ. You are the ones who are his ambassadors today, and you are the ones who have been filled with his love, his peace, his hope and faith to the glory of his name. So on that night when he was betrayed, Jesus was sitting in an upper room with his disciples, and as they had had their fill, he picked up the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body given for you. Eat it in remembrance of me." It is. So, Carol, I invite you to take this bread, being the body of Christ in this place. Eat with a thankful heart, Mike, and for the glory of his kingdom. and after they had eaten the bread, Jesus took the wine, he held it up and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant for you, that you may have eternal life through me." Let's hold on to our wine and we will drink together in unity. We drink together for the glory of his kingdom and for his church. Amen. Amen. Each time we take communion, Lord, we recommit our lives, our hearts and our thoughts and everything to you. As we leave this place, help us to hold on to this fresh remembrance of the story of your life that never grows old and is close to our hearts. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're now going to close our time together this morning by singing what I consider to be one of the greatest modern songs ever written, and it's a privilege for me to sing it. It's a song by Stuart Townend, you know it well, "In Christ Alone." It's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful song that we can sing as we close our time together after communion, that it is in Christ alone that we have our hope, our faith, our love, and our peace for his glory. Would you like to stand with me and we'll sing this together?
My life, my strength, my song. to have asked Stuart Townend why he didn't use that third verse as the last verse, because it always strikes me as the one we should be going out in knowing God's love, his victory for us. So let's sing that last verse again. The third verse. There in the ground his body lay.
Brilliant words. Thank you so much for leading us, Russ and Carol. It's very, very good. Okay, let's pray. We thank you, Lord Jesus, so much that you have given us life, filled us with hope, love, peace, and faith, enabled us to stand, and guided us in the way of truth. Therefore, we commit ourselves to serving you all our days, and to do all we can to bring glory to your name. Amen.
Amen.
Tea and coffee are served. Help yourself.